The Nest of the Cuckoo Birds is one of the most genuinely fascinating grindhouse oddities of its time. Released in 1965, whilst Hollywood cinema was notoriously in financial and creative trouble, stultified by aged stars competing with television and hamstrung by a haze code drawn out into an ever-persistent death rattle, The Nest of the Cuckoo Birds feels like it came from another world. Self-acclaimed in print ads and posters as voted primitive art film of the year, and promising stark naked drama, sadism, quack love and horror, the film actually largely delivers, and it's hard to even think of a better description, as there's such a combination of disparate genres, of conventionally high and low art filtered through an extremely crude, but engagingly atmospheric sense of style, composition and editing. The opening act is bewildering, and bizarrely structured as it jumps into the middle of new situations with each scene. Its amateurish and often surreal production qualities are present from the first shot, which starts rather unceremoniously on a fade-in of our protagonist, Lieutenant Johnson, briskly introducing himself and being taken into a meeting with a police captain. The scene only becomes weirder and weirder. There is a cacophonous audio bed of an army of typists, seemingly just out of frame.
Thanks. Well, you ready for your trip?
Yeah.
Johnson?
They have a bizarrely abstracted conversation about some kind of mission Johnson is to go on against moonshiners working out in the Florida swamps. His captain reminds him that his father was a moonshiner before being betrayed and killed by his partners in crime, and that Johnson therefore has a vendetta against bootleggers, although in actual fact he just seems wistfully reflective about the whole situation rather than out for any kind of revenge. Meanwhile, the camera starts cross-cutting erratically, with the audio dropping in and out as Johnson begins a totally left-field romantic reminiscence about a past or possibly present lover. The scene then transitions, and we see the ramshackle style of southern gothic environment that will characterize the rest of the film emerge. It's all rather bewildering, with character introductions, plot developments and flashbacks all cutting into each other. The total disconnect between audio and picture and the irregular rhythm generated by the back and forth cutting are contrasted against surprisingly romantic and dramatic images, framed with care and an instinctive eye for composition. And so, as the movie's theme plays over the titles, accompanied with folky storybook sketches, there is still very little indication as to what the film will actually end up being. After the titles, the story has jumped forward in time, as Johnson has had his cover blown and is in the process of escaping the murderous bootleggers through the Florida Everglades. After a rather long and laborious sequence of rough location shooting comes perhaps the most startling moment of the film. The scene is clearly based on Psycho, but In the Nest of the Cuckoo Birds delivers a far more jagged and impulsive gender-flipped incarnation than Hitchcock's almost clinical and voyeuristic original. Here, ending in a desperate and animalistic scramble in the mud, versus Hitchcock's chillingly drawn-out examination of a beautiful female corpse. This sequence will inevitably be the most often remarked single moment, however the peculiarities and contradictions of the film are only just getting started. Johnson eventually stumbles across the eponymous Nest of the Cuckoo Birds Inn, secluded amongst the overgrown swampy backwaters. He is helped by the hotel's caretaker, played by an actor wearing incredibly crude makeup to appear older. He generally just looks almost zombie-like. While Johnson recovers, we are also introduced to the owner, an abusively psychotic mother who is actually never referred to by name, and her debilitated waifish daughter Lisa. The rest of the film deals with Johnson's meandering investigation into this decaying inn, as he tries to figure out the exact nature of this warped family unit, and discover where the naked woman who tries to murder him came from. To this end, the second act actually largely consists of the sexual tension Johnson develops with the mother, whilst trying to avoid confrontation with the increasingly agitated and suspicious caretaker. As such, this mother character becomes the focal point of the drama.
Oh, you! You must pray, young man! You must pray! We have a chapel here, and even our guests must pray!
While while she goes on puritanical diatribes and proclaims to hate all men, she is also inexplicably drawn to Johnson. Her psychosexual urges and paranoias are explained surprisingly clearly as she plainly describes to Johnson that she was once a beautiful showgirl, that her daughter is crazy, sex-obsessed, and tried to sleep with her husband, driving him away. Her rants obviously reveal her inner sexual urges and jealousy of Lisa's youth and beauty. This middle section of the film is really reminiscent of The Fugitive Kind, based on Tennessee Williams' Orpheus Descending, showing a highly stylized Southern Gothic setting and striking high contrast cinematography that combined to straddle the line between grimy realism and eccentric melodrama. Cuckoo Birds is also soaked in the same sweaty, lounging melancholy, staged in darkened rooms with lengthy takes that languish. Narratively, they are even similar, featuring a vagrant protagonist, dependent on being taken in by an older woman, and consequently becoming unwillingly drawn into a warped love triangle with both her and a young girl. The creator of the film was a fan of Tennessee Williams, so these commonalities might not be so coincidental. The finale switches gears again, however, back into more familiar horror territory. One of Johnson's pursuers is killed by the mysterious naked knife wielder, and he discovers the caretaker performing taxidermy on the corpse. Johnson breaks Lisa out of her chains but can't help investigating the chapel, finding it full of taxidermied corpses, other men who are unfortunate enough to stumble across the inn.
Hey! Hey, listen!
This scene is honestly the biggest letdown of the film. It's staged incredibly clumsily, with furniture and bad lighting obscuring a lot of the shots, and the comically bad dummies cluttering up the floor with Johnson flailing them around in indignant anger. The knife killer appears, only to fall and instantly die, having coincidentally landed on a meat hook. She's of course revealed to be the mother. There are still moments of high camp though, when the caretaker arrives to give an impassioned speech extolling how he loved her, that all men deserved to die, and that they were happy here in solitude.
You mean killing people isn't bothering them? Only those that invaded Ireland. They were old men, like you. Destroyers of the human race. The misery bearers of the world. They just kept coming. Invading our privacy.
In some ways, the final reveal anticipates the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, with a claustrophobic and isolated central southern location and a deranged family, characterized by the murderous hatred of outsiders and twisted sanctification of preserved corpses. However, a surprising amount of time and gravitas is given to the caretaker's twisted grief, lending the film an air of genuine sympathy for the isolated and mentally ill woman and her impotent carer. Finally, the film ends on moments of genuine surreality, as Lisa and Johnson watch the inn burning down in the distance, suddenly transformed into a huge mansion in a heavily processed shot of a miniature, whilst Lisa's love theme blasts with distortion out on the soundtrack. Cutting back, the dialogue is muted, despite Lisa exclaiming emphatically, for some reason cut off and with the shot taken from a distance. You're left with a bizarre, melancholy feeling as though the film abruptly has lost interest and is abandoning her to an uncertain fate. The movie was the vision of Burt Williams. As financier, director, screenwriter and star, his colourful life in the outside periphery of Hollywood has been revealed due to the research of Bob Mayer in his amazing article on BNWR, Burt Williams' Stark Raving Drama, which includes interviews with Burt's children and a wealth of archive material. In short, Burt has spent years as a background actor in Hollywood, helped by his short marriage to John Ford's niece, before relinquishing his acting ambitions to establish a thriving fitness studio business, which even expanded to a handful of locations, and to settle down with his family in Florida. However, his artistic inclinations would never cease, and he decided to make his own films, cast himself as the lead, write, direct, produce, edit, be his own cinematographer, and become a master of his own destiny, with little to no previous technical experience. But his desire to be in a position to fully demonstrate his acting talents are what give the film a lot of his character. Burt recruited his cast from local amateur dramatics. He himself had played the role of Big Daddy in a local production of Cat on a Hot Tin Roof, and would dubiously claim that Tennessee Williams said he was the best Big Daddy he had ever seen. Both him and his cast seemingly made no distinction between the style and needs of the stage and the screen in their approach, giving large performances to the camera, of which they are awkwardly aware of at all times.
Okay. You didn't eat your sandwich.
Guess not. But I could eat a horse now.
All of the cast have memorable tics, such as Burt's arched eyebrows, side looks, and constant inflections at the end of sentences when Johnson's suspicions are aroused. The man-killing mother is transfixing, with the actress always overwhelmingly aware of the camera and her own expressions throughout her strangely engaging rants and camp posturing.
I've had my fill of that kind of trash.
She is particularly reluctant to ever turn away from the camera, Rather than the stiff or emotionless acting that usually sucks the life and pacing out of B-movies, the performances in Nest of the Cuckoo Birds keep the atmosphere alive with strangeless and an almost inexplicable tension. However, despite Burt's perhaps more lofty ambitions, primarily the film was distributed and advertised in Grindhouse and local independent theatres as a roughie, a just-emerging subgenre of the sexploitation film that was made possible by relaxations in American obscenity laws at the turn of the 60s and the ability to release films without submitting to the MPAA. Roughies were distinguished from the earlier, largely innocent and goofy sexploitation films by their darker, more sadistic subject matter and by emphasising the sinful, depraved nature of sexual situations with a tongue-in-cheek fire and brimstone-like zeal in advertising materials. Despite its more cerebral and sincerely dramatic style rather than the genre's transparently crude and disturbingly ubiquitous rape scenes and kidnapping situations, the film's mix of eroticism and horror, the naked murder scenes, a sadistic older woman holding a young beauty hostage, were enough to place the film into a convenient subgenre to sell to theatres that would show these kinds of pictures. Eventually, the film was rediscovered by the Harvard Film Archive in a print collection of obscure exploitation and regional low-budget productions, which had been accumulated by a private collector and were donated by the Little Arts Cinema in Rockport. Conservator Liz Kofi took the movie under her wing, identifying it as a lost film and recognising its strange charms and possible cult appeal. The film was granted a restoration and was presented as the inaugural release on Nicholas Winden Refn's BuyNWR.com, a multimedia platform where restored, rare and idiosyncratic films are released alongside background material and original creations. In an alternate universe, Burt Williams would have joined the ranks of exploitation cult figures, but Cuckoo Birds failed to take off, as several local distributors and eventually Burt working by himself could never get more than short runs, with apparently disappointing receipts. He even had plans for future productions that promised eccentric concepts, advertising them to potential investors with declared budgets, but he seemingly could not get the funding to continue. According to Bob Mayer's research, the film was last shown in 1967, before becoming totally lost. However, thanks to the work of the conservationists and enthusiasts, Nest of the Cuckoo Birds will live on as a one-off mark on film history.